Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 6th of March 2021, and these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, because you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs. All right, so you can go through our lectures, which has been uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. Okay, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, and you will be getting the daily current affairs classes. Okay, and apart from that, you can also study the daily newspaper, that is the Hindu, okay, as well as the Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer either the Hindu or Indian Express, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, which has been uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, so first is the India-Sweden virtual summit. Okay, so as the name suggests, it is not the real summit, or it is not in a meeting, which is the physically the presence, but it is on the internet, or it is on some platform which has been connected through the internet. So it is on virtual platform, okay, not the real meeting that is happens on the person to person, but it is happening on the virtual platform, that is it's happening on on some with some video conferencing or something like that. So it's happening on the virtual platform. Okay, so this meeting is being held between the Indian Prime Minister and the Sweden Prime Minister, H.E. Stefan Löfven. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the Swedish Prime Minister H.E. Stefan have held the virtual summit. Okay, in the virtual summit, they both have discussed the bilateral issues, right? The bilateral important issues, as well as other regional and the multilateral issues, right, which are of the mutual interest. Mutual interest means the interest which is basically related to the India and Sweden. Okay, so apart from the bilateral issues, some of the issues like regional and multilateral issues also been discussed in this virtual summit, right? Okay, now Prime Minister Narendra Modi, while in this virtual summit, expressed his happiness and recalled his 2018 visit. Okay, when the Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited the Sweden for the first India Nordic summit. Okay, at that point of the time there was no corona, so the Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited and participated the India Nordic summit. And later in 2019, the King and the Queen of the Sweden also visited India. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi recalled both of these visits, right? In 2018 he visited, and 2019 the King and Queen of Sweden has visited India. Okay, now the both of these leaders, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Prime Minister Stefan, both of these leaders basically expressed their satisfaction, right, of the implementation of joint action plan, okay, that was signed, okay, and the joint innovation partnership that was agreed when the Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited the Sweden for the first India Nordic summit in 2018. Okay, so at that point of the time, the joint action plan was agreed between India and Sweden, and the joint innovation partnership agreement was also signed. Okay, these two were basically related to the bilateral agreement, was a part of bilateral agreement. Now both of sides basically agreed to set up, right, and to implement this joint action plan and joint innovation partnership. Okay, and both are satisfied with the progress which have been made under this agreement. Okay, now the Sweden has decided to join the International Solar Alliance. The International Solar Alliance was set up, right, with a greater contribution from India and the France in 2015. Okay, and later many other countries also joined the International Solar Alliance, ultimately to reduce the global footprint related to the carbon. Okay, and to reduce some sort of anthropogenic the gases which has been released from from various sources, like from industries, from vehicular pollution, right, from various sources. So the International Solar Alliance is basically an intergovernmental alliance which has been promoting the solar energy, right, throughout the world. So it has been promoting the research and the development in the solar energy, So the Sweden has decided to join the International Solar Alliance, and the Prime Minister Narendra Modi welcomed, you know, the Sweden's move to join International Solar Alliance. Okay. Then next, both of these leaders also, you know, noted the growing number, you know, membership of the India and Sweden initiatives. So that initiative was basically known as the LEAD ID, that is Leadership Group on the Indus Tri Transition. Okay. That has been launched as a part of the UN Climate Action Summit that was happened in 2019 in the New York. Okay. So you can see this is a map of the Sweden, which is the capital of, I mean, capital is Stockholm. Okay. You can see basically the, you know, the neighboring countries. You have the Norway, then the Finland. Okay. You have the Baltic Sea to the southern side. Then you have the Denmark. So these are, you know, some of the, you know, neighboring countries nearby to the Sweden. Okay. Next, the first strategic counter-terrorism dialogue between India and the Nigeria. Okay. So Nigeria is an African country. All of you know. Okay. So first time, right, India and the Nigeria has conducted a dialogue, right, related to the counter-terrorism, you know, issues. So both of these countries, I mean, both India and the Nigeria, both of these countries are basically adversely impacted due to the terrorism related issues. Not only these countries, but also almost throughout the world, almost all countries have experienced the terrorism related issues. And every country is basically impacted, negatively impacted because of the terrorism. So this is the first time, right, the India and the Nigeria is basically, you know, going to have a dialogue that too related to the terrorism. Okay, so both of these countries, right, as you know, the National Security Advisor of Nigeria, which is basically visited India for the first such dialogue. So this is the dialogue between the both NSAs, both National Security Advisors of India and both National Security Advisors of Nigeria. Both of these, say, you know, NSAs basically would discuss, right, you know, all counter-terrorism related issues, right, how to tackle the terrorism, right, between specifically between India and Nigeria, right? So this type of dialogue will be held, right, at the level of NSA, right? So national security advisors of the both the countries will be discussing and, you know, deliberating on this dialogue. Okay. Now, within this framework or within this dialogue, right, both close and a strategic, you know, partnership, which has been needed between India and Nigeria so that they can discuss, right, in depth, the issues related to the terrorism, right, which are related to the threats and the challenges which are faced by, you know, the democratic societies like India. Okay, so the societies which is facing, you know, some sort of a issues like terrorism, extremism, radicalization, which is also would be part of this dialogue. Okay, so two sides, right, in this, you know, NSA's labeled dialogue, two sides would fight, first of all, identify some of the specific areas of cooperation. Obviously, in the specific areas of the cooperation, these areas should be common, okay, should be common in order to, you know, have this dialogue. So this specific areas of the cooperation would be, first of all, would be identified, would be discussed, right, so that, you know, any form of the terrorism, whether it is related to the extremism, radicalization, would be discussed, right, and would be deliberated upon, right, and there should be no justification for the terrorism in any form, okay, whether it is, you know, for the nationalism or whether it is related to, you know, the protection of the minority or whether it is related to anything, right? There is no justification of the terrorism. Terrorism has to be end. Okay. So this is the map of Nigeria. Okay. You can see, you know, the political map of Nigeria. Okay. Next, the Indian Medicine Pharmaceutical Corporation Limited. Okay. It is a public sector undertaking company, right, under the Ministry of Ayush. Okay, the ultimate aim of this Indian Medicines Pharmaceutical Corporation Limited, right, is to promote the Ayurvedic and Unani medicines. Okay, specifically, you know, because it comes under, you know, Ayush, Ministry of Ayush. It is a public sector undertaking company. So why this Indian Medicine Pharmaceutical Corporation Limited, IMPCL, is in the news? It is in the news because, you know, the IMPCL and government e-market, which is basically, you know, an online portal. Okay, both of these have tied up. Okay, so MOU was signed between the IMPCL and government e-market, that is GEM portal. Okay, to promote, you know, some of the medicines online. So the IMPCL's medicines, which are related to the Ayurveda and Yunani medicines, would be sold, right, or as an online product through this portal, which is the government e-market portal. So obviously, the government e-market portal would provide a platform for selling of these medicines, right? And various governmental agencies basically can procure, right, these medicines of Ayurvedic and Yunani, okay, directly from the government e-market portal. And the most important benefit is that this portal is basically regulated by the government of India, okay, specifically the Ministry of Finance, Department of Agriculture, Department of Expenditure. Okay, so the Ministry of Finance basically, fixed, right, the prices which has been, related to the medicines of Ayurvedic and the Yunani, and which has been sold out, right, on this government e-market portal. Okay, so this deal which was finalized between IMPCL and government e-market portal was finalized on 3rd of March 2021. Okay, now with that deal or with that MOU, the government e-market portal has created the 31 categories. Okay, under this 31 categories, it will be including 311 medicines. Now these the IMPCL can now upload these medicines within these categories, okay, which is being created by the government e-market portal for selling of those the medicines. Now with the decision of the government e-market portal, okay, that is GEM, the Ayurvedic and Yunani medicines of IMPCL would be sold out, okay, which will be figured in the GEM portal, okay, and it will be sold out to the government sector buyers. Obviously, you will have different governmental agencies which can procure these medicines at the price which has been fixed and finalized by the Ministry of Finance. Okay, regarding IMPCL, it is a public sector manufacturing unit of Ministry of AYUSH. Okay, and it is the only CPSE under the Ministry of AYUSH, Government of India, right? So which has been selling those medicines on the government e-marketplace portal, and it has been the prices related to those medicines has been finalized by the Ministry of Finance, okay, for their Ayurvedic and the Yunani medicines. All right, next, the National Committee to Commemorate the 75 years of India's independence. Okay, now to celebrate, right, the 75 years of the India's independence, right, since 1947, okay, a national committee is constituted. Okay, this national committee would be headed by Honorable Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi. Okay, the government has constituted this committee to commemorate the 75 years of India's independence. Okay, now the first thing is that it will be, as a part of the commemoration of 75 years of the India's independence. And secondly, it has been headed by the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi. Okay, now, this committee would have 259 members. Okay, among these 259 members, right, the eminent persons or eminent citizens would be participating, and the dignitaries would also be participating from all walk of the life. That means from the different walk of the life, the eminent persons and the dignitaries would be participating in this national committee. Now, what is the purpose of this creation of this national committee? This national committee would provide a direction, okay, the guidelines, specifically because the dignitary and eminent citizens are having some experience with the different walk of the life. Okay, so to inject the fresh thinking, right, into the policy formulation, right, into the program formulation, right, the national committee members would basically infuse the fresh light on the policy direction, on the guidelines which has been formulated related to the programs, right, as a part of the commemoration of 75th anniversary of Indian independence. Okay, now government of India has decided to celebrate, okay, the completion of 75 years of the the India's independence at the national level and the international level. Okay, so to intend to commemorate this 75 years of the India's independence, right, at a befitting manner, both at the national level as well as in the international level, in the form of the Azadi Ke Amrit Mahotsav. Okay, so in the banner called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, which would be commemorating the 75th anniversary of Indian independence, in that the dignitaries and eminent persons would be a part of this national committee, which would provide of, you know, directions and the guidelines related to the programs and all sort of a, you know, the policy formulations. Okay, fine. Then the black broad babbler. Okay, now first you see this picture of this black broad babbler, then we'll continue. Okay, so it is basically Brad Broad Babbler. Okay, now the Brad Broad Babbler is basically a bird, first of all, which has been documented and which has been found, you know, in the Borneo is basically, you know, the, you know, third largest island in the world. Okay, so the Borneo is basically island which has been, you know, politically been, you know, having the three different jurisdictions or three different countries. Okay, so this black brown babbler is a bird which has been found right in the Borneo, which is an island, first time over in 170 years. Okay, now this word which was last recorded, because this word was not found, it was last recorded between 1843 AD and 1848 AD, after 170 years, after 170 years since 1848, this word was again reappeared or documented in the Borneo. Okay, now the scientist collected the first and the only museum specimen related to this black brown babbler. Okay, this black broad babbler is basically the name called Melecocincla persipilata. Okay, it is, you know, the name which is being scientific name of this black broad babbler. It is also known as the songbird species of the family Pelorinidae. Okay, and it is endemic to the Borneo. Borneo endemic means it is only found, right, in the island called Borneo. It is endemic in the Borneo. Now, regarding the IUCN, you know, conservation status list, it is been recorded as a data deficient. That means the sufficient data related to the word is not known. Okay, previously the IUCN has classified this word as the vulnerable species, but now it has been classified as a data deficient because the data is not available regarding this species. Okay, and only the single specimen which has been collected in the 19th century, that was in 1848, was known. Okay, until the word was rediscovered in the Indonesia during 2020. Okay, now regarding the Borneo is basically the third largest island in the world. Okay, it is the third largest island in the world, and it is the largest in the Asia. Okay, and this Borneo is being politically divided, right, between the three countries, or you can say that Borneo Island have, you know, the jurisdiction, right, by the three countries, that is the Malaysia and the Brunei, both having the jurisdiction over the Borneo to the north of the Borneo, and the Indonesia has the jurisdiction over the south of this Borneo Island. Okay, so it is the word. Okay, next, the tea garden workers in the Assam. Now you know that the state legislative assembly's elections are due in the Assam. Okay, every political party is basically eyeing on the tea garden workers, right, which has been having the significant, you know, the electorates in the Assam. Around 17% of the electorates basically belonging to, you know, those tea garden workers. So the BJP, Congress, all parties are eyeing on these votes, which has been, you know, related to these tea garden workers. So recently, the Congress leader Priyanka Gandhi Vadra visited the tea garden, okay, in the Assam state. Okay, and as you know that the Congress is promising that once it comes to the power in the Assam, it will increase the wage or daily wage which has been provided to the tea garden worker, right, to 365 rupees. Okay, so now the Congress is promising that the daily wage related to the tea garden workers would be increased to 365 rupees. Now, as you know that Assam accounts for over half of the India's total tea production, because the tea is produced in the Assam, West Bengal, right, in the neighboring states, in the northeastern states. Now, the Assam has like more than 50% of, you know, the India's total tea production. Okay, and since it is having the, you know, almost half of the India's tea production, obviously the tea garden workers would be more, because the type of production is needed, the workers also would be needed. Okay, Now, regarding this tea garden workers, they are not, I mean, belongs to specifically from the Assam, but they have been brought, right, by the British during, you know, in the 19th century, specifically after 1860. Okay. So these workers basically brought from the states like Orissa, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, and West Bengal specifically to work in the tea gardens after 1860, when the tea was started growing in the Assam state. Okay. Now, these tea garden workers having the different problems, like they have been exploited at the hand of your employer, and they have economically backwardness also because they are poor and somehow they have no fixed wage. They have been exploited. Okay. Their poor conditions are there. Okay. They don't have the medical facilities and other facilities, okay, which has been provided to, you know, to the people. Now they have also problems related to the literacy. So they have low literacy rate also. So that is the reason they have been, you know, exploited in the hand of, you know, basically in the hand of the employers. Now, this tea tribe community, right, which has been, you know, the community where, you know, they work in the tea gardens, comprises around 17% of the state's population. Okay, the 17% of the state population is huge. Now, this 17% of the state population would basically decide the 40 Assam assembly seats. So out of 120 legislative assembly seats, 40 is, you know, is dominated by this tea tribe community. So 40 seats will be a deciding factor for any party to win the election. So almost you can say that almost, you know, 25% basically the share belongs to, you know, your tea garden community in that. Now, the Assam government increased the wages of the tea garden workers from 167 to 217. Now, the Assam government has increased again this wage to garner the support of the, you know, the tea tribe community. Now, the Congress is again, you know, promising that from 270. Now, the Congress is promising that this tea, you know, the daily wage related to tea garden workers would be increased to 365 rupees per day. That is the daily wage. That is the daily wage which is provided to the tea garden workers. Okay. Now, as you know that the tea garden workers already expressed their dissatisfaction, right, with this hike, because they still considered that this hike, which was from 167 to 217, was inadequate for sustaining their life, specifically in this exploited environment. Okay, so you can see the picture, the Priyanka Gandhi Vadra is basically with the tea garden workers in the Assam state. Okay, next, the income tax returns. As you know that the government is collecting the income tax, which is being, you know, filed by, you know, the individuals. So this time the government report says that, you know, there is a contraction of 6.6% in the number of income tax returns, right, which is being filed by the individual, right, which is earning up to 50 lakhs rupees in the financial year 2019 and 2020. So the report says that there was a contraction of 6.6%. That means 6.6%, you know, lesser people have filed, right, you know, the income tax return as an individual who earned up to 50 lakhs rupees in the financial year 2019 and 2020. Okay, this latest data would also show that this income tax return shows that the 9.8% contraction in the filing, right, which has been related to the ITR 1 offline filing, and 4.5% contraction is basically, you know, in the ITR filing, which has been filed online for financial year 2020. So there was 9.8% contraction while filing offline this income tax return, and there was 4.5% contraction while filing this income tax return online for the financial year 2020. Okay, now this ITR 1 Sahaj, which has been, you know, which has been created by the government of India, which is to be filed as income tax return by the resident individual, right, who is not included in the Hindu undivided family as a part of the criteria, right, and having the income of 50 lakhs should be filing the income tax return, okay, on this portal online. Okay, now the total income basically to calculate this, you know, basically for calculating the income tax return, the total income would be calculated as the income from the salary the person is getting, or the income from pension, both, right? So the income will be, you know, can be taken from the salary or the pension. Then income from one house property, okay, whatever the house property you have, the income from other sources, like you have, you know, some bank account, right, balance, so that in that you will have, you will be getting some interest. So the income from, you know, related to that interest will also be calculated. That will be excluding from the lottery, as well as other race course, you know, race sources related to the, you know, those income. Then the income which is taxable under section of 115 BBDA, or the income which has been referred under section 115 BBE, right, which has been basically, you know, taxed under the income tax return, right? And the agricultural income basically would be denoted the income which is up to, you know, 5,000 rupees, up to 5,000 rupees. So this is what is how you calculate your the income. Okay, all right. So that is how you will calculate your income that has been, you know, the for the income tax returns that you have to file, right, either offline or online. And the data shows that there was a contraction related to the filing of the income tax return by the individual who is basically earning up to 50 lakhs of rupees. All right, let's move. The QA none. What is this QA none? So Q means basically the clearance patriot. Okay, the Q term basically referred to the clearance patriot. Okay, fine. Now what is the significance of this QA none? So that is basically, you know, a conspiracy theory. So QA none is basically a conspiracy theory which is being supported, right, the Donald Trump's move. So it's a conspiracy theory which is being related to the pro-Trump, you know, the supporters, which started shaping in 2017 onward. Okay, so these conspiracy theories which was published, right, you know, on the internet by an anonymous user, which is being, you know, identified as a clearance patriot, which started, you know, posting these conspiracy theories online. Now, what happens is this Q, which is related to the clearance. Now, the Q is basically related to the security clearance. Now, what is this security clearance? It has been assumed that in the conspiracy theories, which has been pro-Trump, right, that a US Department of Energy, right, you know, have been given, right, the access for the top secret information, right, which has been related to some sort of a, you know, political issues. So some of the former US President Donald Trump followers, right, believe that this QAnon conspiracy would basically help, you know, the Donald Trump to return to the power on March 4th. But that did not happen. Okay, the Donald Trump defeated very badly. Okay, and the new president Joe Biden have elected to the, you know, to the American presidency. Even the Foreign Bureau of Investigation, which is the premier investigation agency of the USA, have said that these political conspiracy theories, which is including the QAnon, are basically a domestic threat, okay, which has been there with respect to, you know, the domestically, you know, created these theories, which has been, you know, as a domestic threat. Now, the QAnon basically a pro-Trump conspiracy theories, which has been promoted to, you know, by the supporters of the Donald Trump, so that the Donald Trump can come to the power, started, you know, shaping in around 2017, and which has been asked that some sort of a clearance have been given by the Department of Energy for the top secret information or the classified files. Okay, now the followers of this movement believe that the Donald Trump would, you know, come on heavily on such, you know, cables which is being run by the cables of Philadelphia or pedophiles, okay, which is being, you know, owned by the some sort of a Satan. And the Trump supporters basically, you know, believe that the Trump aim as a United States of the president to unmask that cable, okay, and to punish them very heavily. Now, once the Donald Trump basically returned to the power. Now, according to this conspiracy theorist, right, the Trump is secretly preparing to come heavily on this, the cables of pedophiles, okay, for, you know, a day of reckoning. The storm, which has been the, you know, the members of the deep state will be executed. Okay, so here those satans or those who worship this satan will be executed And the Donald Trump is basically secretly preparing for this day, which is being the called a storm day, right? Once the president or once the Donald Trump will return to the power, right? It will heavily come down on this, you know, specifically to the followers, which basically having this information. Okay. Now, the conspiracy theory, you know, there are many theories which were there on the internet. One of the conspiracy theories says that it was, these conspiracy theories were basically related to the pro-Trump. Ultimate aim of creation of this, you know, conspiracy theories is to help the Donald Trump to return to the power, but that did not happen, right? And these theories somehow was baseless also. For example, these conspiracy theories believe that some of the Democrats like Hillary Clinton, right, Barack Obama, then Hollywood actors like Tom Hanks, Oprah Winfrey are the part of the global child sex trafficking ring. So you can say that it is basically to defame some of the, you know, important personalities who were behind the Joe Biden, for example, the Hillary Clinton, right, and the Barack Obama, who supported the Joe Biden's move as a part of or as a candidacy of the US president. So obviously these conspiracy theories were part of the pro Trump, you know, basically, you know, some of, you know, the supporters who basically supported this move, that with that tactics, the Donald Trump may come to the power. Okay. So you can see that this is a QAnon supporter from the pro Trump, you know, side. Okay. Next, the Haryana quota law. So what is that the Haryana government has, you know, has passed a law, that is Haryana State Employment of Local Candidate Bill. So that bill provides that at least 75% of the job, okay, should be reserved to the person who is domiciled from Haryana or who is belonging to the Haryana. So those jobs which are having the salary of 50,000 rupees, okay, the salary up to the 50,000 rupees, such jobs would be notified by the government from the time to time. And in such jobs, right, the domicile certificate is required, and such jobs out of 100%, 75% of the such jobs would be provided to the local residents of Haryana, to the local residents of Haryana. So the Haryana government notified a new law which require the 75% of the private sector jobs. It is only related to the private sector jobs in the state would be reserved or would be having the quota that will be filled by only the local resident of Haryana. So the local candidate will be filled, right, in these jobs. So that government would basically decide, you know, the specified salary slab. Now that is 50,000 rupees. So up to 50,000 rupees, the bill will provide that at least 75% of such jobs will be filled, okay, through, you know, through the local candidate, which is being there with respect to, you know, Haryana. Okay. Now, this law would be applicable to all companies, I mean the private sector companies, societies, trusts, limited liability partnership firms, and any person if that employment, right, is more than 10 people or more, right? If that type of employer or that type of, you know, industries is basically employing 10 or more people, this law will be applicable, and they have to compulsory recruit 75% of, you know, the people from the local or from the people who are domiciled in Haryana, as notified by the government from the time to time. Okay. Now, the constitution basically provides the guarantee for the reservation, right? That too, to the public sector employment. Okay. Now, this is the private sector employment, right? It is a private sector employment quota. Now, you can understand that this is not new. This is not new. In 2019, the Andhra Pradesh government has also passed this type of law. Okay, which was ultimately challenged in the court of the law. Okay, so with that, there was a lot of issues related to, because of passes of this Andhra Pradesh government law, and it was basically challenged in the court of the law. Similar law was passed again by the Haryana. Okay, let's see what will happen. The people will definitely move to the court, because by reserving 75% of those jobs belonging to the domiciled people from Haryana is obviously, you know, restricting, right, the free movement of, you know, some of the persons who are already in the job, right? There's many people would lose the job, obviously, with that notification, who are already working. And as it will be only filled through the domiciled people, obviously, right, the number of, you know, the workers would also be impacted because of this move. Okay. And this has been done because if you see this graph, right, the state worse than national. Okay, the state condition or the Haryana state's condition is worse than the national average. So the red is basically shown with the Haryana's graph, and the blue is basically shown as a India's graph. So you can see the unemployment rate on the monthly basis. So unemployment percentage, you can see here from August 17th, right? From August 17th to basically you see the February 21st, okay? Or 2017 August to February 2021, okay? This data is given. So this 17 is basically the year. This is the year 2017. And this is 21 is basically the 2021. This is the year. So you can see the highest rate of the unemployment rate that was there specifically in the month of May, in the month of May 20, right? And it was around 20% of the unemployment rate was recorded, okay? Even beyond 20% at the national level, okay? In the Haryana, this rate was at the peak, that was 42.2%, okay? Now, if you see that type of report or that type of unemployment rate that was very high, for example, if you see it was when the Haryana was there, the lowest was 4.1%. It was reaching to the peak, that was 43.2%. And now in February 2021, it was 26.4%. And at the national level, it is just 6.9%. So if you compare with this one, almost four times, you know, the unemployment rate is there, right, in the Haryana when compared with the national average. Okay, next, the Gersen. The Gersen is basically a tehsil in the Chamoli district. Okay, the Gersen is basically tehsil in the Chamoli district. Okay, now why this Gersen is the news? The Gersen is the news because the chief minister of Uttarakhand has decided, okay, first of all, right, that, you know, the Gersen would be, you know, the summer capital of Uttarakhand. Now, after announcing this, that the Gersen, which is in tehsil in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand, right, after announcing that it will be a summer capital of Uttarakhand, the chief minister again declared that now the Gersen would be the administrative division of the state also, right? With declaring of this administrative division of the state, now the Uttarakhand will have three such administrative divisions. Now, the first is basically Kumau, second is Garhwal, and the third is basically your Gersen, okay? And it will also have a commissionerate also. That means a commissioner would be sitting or commissioner would be there in the Gersen because it will be declared as a administrative division of the state, okay? Regarding the Gersen is a tehsil. Now, it has been converted as a division since it has been declared as an administrative division of the state. Okay, since it has been declared as a division, so it will be called as a Gersen division. Now, this Gersen division will have the four hill districts. Okay, that is Almora and Bageshwar. This both of these districts are there in the Kumaon Himalayan side. And Rudraprayag and the Chamoli, both of these districts falls in the Garhwal Himalaya. So you have the Kumaon Himalaya and Garhwal Himalaya. And the Gersen basically lies in between this Garhwal Himalaya and Kumaon Himalaya. And currently falls or currently basically comprising of these four hill districts. Okay. Now a commissioner would be sitting in the Gersen because it will be declared as a third commissionerate. A DIG will also be sitting over there. Okay. And as you know that on the March 4th last year, the chief minister of Uttarakhand has declared specifically during the budget session that the Gersen would be the summer capital of the state, right? And even the governor of the Uttarakhand have given the assent for the declaration of the, you know, the Gersen as the summer capital of the Uttarakhand, right? Which was declared, right, as a part of the move of the government of India, so government of Uttarakhand. So Gersen is basically a tehsil in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand, which is located 270 kilometers away from the basically Dehradun, which is a temporary capital of Uttarakhand. Now you must understand that Dehradun was declared as a capital specifically when the Uttarakhand was basically carved out of the Uttar Pradesh. It was declared as a temporary capital, okay, in November 9, 2000. but it was declared because it is having the planar areas. Okay, but the Gersen, which will be best suited for the hilly state like Uttarakhand, because of the mountainous the area which is falls in the Uttarakhand state. So the Gersen would be best suited as a capital of the mountainous state, since it is being located between the Kumaon Himalaya and the Garhwal Himalayan region both. So it is being located in between them. But now this Dehradun, which is being declared as a capital, it was declared as a temporary capital because of the planar area. Okay. So you can see the Dehradun, which is being located in the planar area, and the Gersen is basically in between your the Kumaon Himalaya and Garhwal Himalaya. And it will be the best suited as a summer capital of the Uttarakhand. Okay. So that's all for the today. And we will meet again tomorrow for next current affairs. Thank you very much for those who attended this class. Thank you.